Eyes wide shut.
Yeah, it was my wife.
And this is a mystery?
Modern thriller about sexual obsession and jealousy.
Now, after months of secrets and mystery, Nicole
all the rumors will be put to rest about Eyes Wide Shut.
After a year and a half of intense filming, it seemed to take a toll on Hollywood's royal couple.
Cruise reveals that making Eyes Wide Shut was such an intense experience that it gave him an ulcer.
The craziest rumor.
I don't think any of them I can repeat. Some of them I can't repeat on national television.
They said it had to do with necrophilia. Good stuff.
Their marriage will not survive this. It didn't, and neither did Stanley. He died the day after he finished editing.
Sidney Pollack says the controversial movie may scare off some audiences with its frank scenes of sexuality. The famed director was shocked at rumors surrounding the film.
The explicit love scene led to tabloid reports that Tom and Nicole had on-set instructors showing them how to make love.
Kubrick's longest gestating projects.
In the 60s, he read the book, and he bought the rights to Traumnovelle by Arthur Schnitzler, 1970, and then he did not proceed because he found it too difficult to get a script together, which he liked. He was his strongest critic.
People always say he was obsessive, he was such a perfectionist, as if this was something bad. He was incredibly self-critical and careful and wanted to do something that is really right and remains. And, you know, all his films remain.
And since it is a very internal story, and since everybody in the audience is an expert on the topic of jealousy and sexual fantasy, he found it very, very tricky to do this. And he gave up. What might interest you is that maybe 15 years later, he actually wanted to do it as a black and white art house film with Woody Allen in the lead, as a Jewish doctor in New York. It would have been a serious film. It would have been slightly different. But he, again, was not happy with his script, although he was extremely happy for a week of doing it like this. And so we prepared other films, and finally, after we had prepared Aryan Papers and gave up on it for other reasons, and AI, and did Eyes Wide Shut.
Stanley at first wanted to do it in many different ways, even as a comedy at one point. And then as he thought about it all those years, he felt he had to strip away all the ordinary problems that couples have and choose a couple that they have no problems. They're good looking, they are happy together, they are rich, they're healthy. Nothing is in their way that isn't of their own making. And there starts the story that he was interested in. He was not thinking of himself as a moralist, but he was very interested in the Schnitzler novel, really hooked on it. And I read that Schnitzler and Freud were friends and were two people at the time who thought about morals outside the rules of religion and church things. So Stanley really hooked in on this. Then when he had decided to do it with a couple who had really no excuse to behave in the way they did, they had it coming, and they made each other hugely unhappy.
Well, he had never any alternative other than Tom. He absolutely wanted Tom Cruise. We never thought of anybody else. And then he saw Nicole Kidman in a film called To Die For. And he realized how brilliant she was holding a close-up for long takes. Initially, he didn't want to have a couple. He thought it was a disadvantage. But then he saw Nicole after he had checked other actresses, and he went to Tom and said, do you think it would be a good idea? And he said, yeah, we'd love to work together. Wonderful. So, and that's how it happened. And then he very much homed in on what Tres Christiana said, that actually, really, it's a great idea to have a couple that are so perfect and they have everything. You know, they are on the top of the world. Maybe that factor alone contributes to the story.
I think also just in terms of working as a married couple together, there's an intimacy that you're allowed. I mean, you can touch each other. Sometimes with another actor, you have to build up that trust. You just immediately, you know, you have that. Like I remember in the scene when we were doing the nightmare scene, I call it, where he comes home and I'm in bed. And we did that took quite a long time to shoot, and we were working on that. And just having Tom there, who knows me and knows emotionally what can trigger me and stuff, he could whisper things to me before a take that would immediately put me into the scene. And the power of that, that was something that, you know, a lot of the time you don't have with another actor. Another time, but then the other thing is you do go home and it lives with you for 24 hours a day. You are connected for a very, very long period in work and in your private life. You know, as an actor, you set up, there's reality and there's pretend, and those lines get crossed. And it happens when you're working with a director that allows that to happen. It's a very exciting thing to happen. It's a very dangerous thing to happen as well. And when it does happen, I think that's when the work becomes so much more than just making a film. That we read somewhere, oh, Stanley cast us because he, I don't think, I mean, the thing about Stanley was he never explained his motives, he never explained why. He would get irritated if you asked him, so what does this mean, or why did you cast us, or tell me the meaning of this scene, how do you want me to play it? That irritated him. He wanted, he hated to have to explain. And I remember I had a conversation with him once, and he said, so much of being a director is instinct. Thus, when you're asked why too much, it throws your instinct into doubt, which is, as a director, you're the leader. And you cannot, a lot of the time, creatively, it'd be like asking a painter, Picasso, why did you use blue? I mean, there's no answer to the why. It just is. And so I think that's why he didn't like to be asked, what's the meaning of the film? What are you trying to say with this film? The film and all his films are what he wanted to say, and there's nothing more to say.
I'm going to wave the European flag a little bit here. It's a European film. It's a very European story. Arthur Schnitzler was one of the most important writers of his time. He was a friend of contemporary of Sigmund Freud. He had correspondence with Sigmund Freud. It came from an innovative nest of ideas. It is very European. The film is very serious. The key content is not Vienna in the 20s and the 30s. It's universal. The style is very European. The film treads on people's shoes, on their toes. It gets too close. There are certain topics which in some societies are not discussed. Death, religion, politics, and serious sex. Frivolous sex you can discuss as much as you want. This here is serious. So, for some people, the film gets too close. They don't want to be told anything like that because they know it. And they are right. They know it. They are all experts. You are all experts on the topic. Everybody. But there's nobody who doesn't relate to what's going on. For some people, that's uncomfortable. But hopefully, for many, many people in Paris, it will be a film that will be embraced.
What did he want? Sex. Upstairs. Then and there.
Is that all?
Yeah. Yeah, that was all.
Just wanted to fuck my wife.
That's right.
Well, I guess that's understandable.
Understandable. Bill thinks, okay, we're gonna have sex now. He's all settling in for the night, and he says one thing. It happens to be the wrong thing, and it triggers a number of reactions from me, which is so real.
Because I'm a beautiful woman, the only reason any man ever wants to talk to me is because he wants to fuck me? Is that what you're saying?
I mean, this happens to all of us in our relationships. And you see Bill sort of reeling from it. I think it's a very funny scene. I love Stanley's humor, so, and it really comes across in that scene. And then he takes it into that dangerous territory of where I am just spewing things, saying things that I
have held back for so long that just sort of happened to come out at this particular time on this particular night. And I find that fascinating, but so real.
And I thought if he wanted me, even if it was only for one night, I was ready to give up everything. You, Helena, my whole fucking future.
So many times when you're making a movie, you're bound by a structure mm-hmm. that, you know, sometimes you look back and think, God, if I, you know, now I know why. Now I have the idea of what I was looking for. And Stanley would take that time to allow it to evolve. And hence, when he was working on a scene, it would just be the three of us. He'd watch us walk around, and then it would depend. He'd look at the staging, but he'd first work on, let's get the scene right. And he would rewrite every single day. He rewrote, you know, even when he was cutting, he's rewriting, working. So there wasn't a large crew. It was intimate, very intimate group. And when he was shooting, sometimes, you know, it was just Stanley on the set, depending, you know, or the camera operator.
Because
he could operate the camera also.
We worked on that scene for, I think it was about 2 or 3 weeks, because it was the pivotal scene in the film. I remember when I first read the script, I thought, oh, this is, it's very rare as an actor that you're asked to speak for more than 2 or 3 minutes with a monologue. And I was terrified of that monologue when I first read it. And also I thought, what a great challenge. But we basically spent time in the room on the set, which was built, the apartment, and the three of us, and we worked on the scene, and Stanley rewrote it and then worked on a little bit more and rewrote it again. And we sort of found the scene over a period of a couple of weeks. And it was incredible how he also decided to shoot it. He watched us on the bed, and because it's such a long scene, I mean, I think it goes on for almost 14 minutes all up, doesn't it? He constructed the shots by just watching us, and he actually, what was it? He had it on an arm, didn't he?
Yeah. The
thing. And so we were allowed to play it out for the whole duration of the mag, which means that you get to play the whole scene without having to cut, which was great as an actor. It's like doing theater. It was interesting how when you do not dispel a rumor within, you know, 24 hours, it can become fact. And I think we really saw that in relation to this film. I mean, nobody confirmed or denied anything for about a year and a half. And so within that time, suddenly the plot of the film, everything, no matter how far-fetched it was, had become truth. And we were reading in reputable newspapers and stuff that these were facts, and they obviously were not. So.
The last day of shooting, a day that I, you know, had both looked forward to and dreaded, you know, looked forward to because I just, you know, there was enough with Dr. Bill in some ways, you know, and dreaded because I didn't want the experience with Stanley to end. And now I shared 3 years of my life with this man. And even when I went to the funeral, going to the funeral, I was not in a good way, and I was very concerned about Nick and very concerned about Christian and his family, and concerned about the movie, you know, because I know what it meant to him and what it meant to me, and my wife, my co-star, my love.
He would tell me the last couple of years of his life, when we were talking about the form, he kept saying, I want to change the form. I want to make a movie that changes the form. And I said, well, didn't you that with 2001? He said, just a little bit, but not enough. I really want to change the form. So we kept looking for different ways to tell stories.
And I didn't want to believe it because it just seemed wrong. Didn't seem like the right time. He seemed to have too many other things to do and say. And it's still very, sorry.
I'll move from that just for a second.
Well, I don't know what everyone was expecting. The movie is, you know, like all Stanley's movies, they have a life beyond the opening or the first run. I mean, you look at Stanley's movies, they're for life, and you look at it, you know, in the pantheon of film, you look at Stanley Kubrick. If you want to know movies, you're going to have to look at Stanley Kubrick's pictures. His movies have always done actually better foreign than they have domestic, even at a time when domestic box office was the main, which it no longer is. I mean, you know, Stanley's films have always done better foreign. But even beyond that, you look at the life of his movies. That's why he was able to make the movies and have the money, because of having, you know, for a studio to have Stanley Kubrick in their library, it's huge. So, I mean, you know, you can't...
The film has a problem. You have to see it twice. And that is a problem. The film was not at all successful in the beginning in Northern Europe, in America, in the English-speaking world. It was only successful in the Latin world, in France, Portugal, Spain, Italy, fabulous, and Japan, instantly, but not at all here. And now it's slowly coming back, and I'm convinced that a future generation will use Eyes Wide Shut like they use Ingmar Bergman and other great filmmakers to get a real good, serious look at our time, or the, let's say the second half of the 20th century.